Back from the hot zone, healthcare workers meet with the US president as the debate heats up over whether they should be quarantined after treating patients with Ebola. Also ahead, sign of recovery? The Federal Reserve says it will no longer pump money into the US economy. We'll see how US markets are reacting. And later, convoys of reinforcements head to Kobani, a welcome sight for the Syrian Kurds fighting ISIS. But is it enough to swing the momentum of the battle? CNN Newscenter starts right now.
Hello everyone, I'm Lynda Kinkade. We're awaiting US President Barack Obama, who is preparing to speak to healthcare workers returning from the Ebola zone in West Africa. We'll bring you his remarks from the East Room of the White House live when it happens. Mr. Obama's speech comes the same day as the US military announced that any personnel returning from Ebola-stricken countries will be under quarantine for 21 days. The move appears to run counter to President Obama's policies towards civilian workers. But he says the difference is soldiers have been sent by him while the healthcare workers are volunteers. As the Ebola quarantine debate rages on, one civilian nurse who worked in West Africa is refusing to stay isolated in her home. Officials in the US state of Maine put Casey Hickox under a 21-day quarantine as a precaution. But Hickox maintains she has no symptoms of the virus. Meantime, the World Health Organization has released new numbers on the Ebola outbreak. There are now more than 13,700 cases in West Africa. And the WHO expects the death toll to pass the 5,000 mark very soon. But there is a glimmer of hope. The WHO says it appears the rate of Ebola infections is slowing down inside Liberia, the hardest hit country. But the organization cautions that the virus still poses a significant threat for much of West Africa. Right now, only about half of all Ebola patients are surviving the disease. US photojournalist Ashuka Makpo is one of those survivors. He contracted the virus in Liberia while working as a cameraman for the US network NBC. Our Don Lemon sat down with Makpo at his home in Providence, Rhode Island, to talk about his harrowing experience with Ebola.
It's like nothing that I had ever experienced. It was a bit like a flu in the sense that there was body aches and chills and fever, but they were so pronounced and so much more intense than anything that you're likely to get with a flu, unless it's a, you know, terrible flu that lands you in the ICU, that it would be hard for me to say, oh, you know, did you feel this way once? Well, this is what Ebola is like. Right. You know, it's definitely different.
Pain?
Yeah, there was pain, certainly muscle pain, muscle aches, very high fever. I think at one point my fever was at 104. But I think the thing that was the most pronounced for me almost out of everything was the weakness, the physical weakness. And I used to see people who would be laying in front of treatment centers trying to get admitted, and you know, they're just laying out in the ground, in the gravel, in the sun, and I used to look at them and say, my God, you know, you can't sit up at least. And then once I was sick, I completely understood. You just have absolutely no energy. To walk 3 feet feels like you just ran a marathon.
You can't move.
Not very much, no.
And you were, as I said, you're in isolation, so can you even see the faces of the people who are treating you?
You can see their eyes.
You can see their eyes.
Yeah.
You can hear the rest of Don Lemon's interview with Ashuka Makpo later on CNN Tonight. The US Federal Reserve has just formally announced an end to its controversial economic stimulus program known as quantitative easing. Wall Street has been mostly flat all day ahead of the Fed's announcement, which came in the past hour. Here's a live look at what the Dow Jones is doing at this hour. And you can see it's down 29 points. To better understand the move, the Fed's move, we turn to Richard Quest, and he joins us now from New York. Richard, what does this announcement mean, and what does it say about the current state of the economy?
Well, I think if you first of all look, and we have a quick look back at the Dow again, you'll see exactly how the market sort of reacted. The market had been tootling along quite happily, really, which had even had some gains. And then that splash of red immediately after we get these minutes. These are the minutes from the latest Fed Open Market Committee. Now, we knew that they were going to stop printing money. We've known that for many months. But what was in this detail of this document is the what they now believe will be the future rate of interest rates going up. When will rates rise? We knew the printing was stopping, but this gives us an indication the Fed is more bullish about growth. In other words, the hawks may be winning the day. They use phrases like solid job gains. There's a lower unemployment rate. Energy prices are down. All these things are suggesting that the economy will pick up speed and therefore rates may go up sooner rather than later, probably middle of next year.
The Fed has paused its stimulus campaign several times since the global financial crisis, only to restart it again. Is it safe to say it won't be needed again in the next few months?
No, it's not. I think that's a very good point. And the Fed is very keen to say, all right, QE3 is gone. Now we say at the moment that rates won't go up for a considerable time. That's the phrase. But they're very clear. October's statement is different from September's. October's statement basically says if things are better, rates will go up. If things are worse, they won't. The feeling in the market is that the Fed is telegraphing that it might be sooner rather than later.
Richard Quest in New York, thanks very much. We appreciate your time. In Syria, reinforcements are arriving to help the beleaguered Kurdish fighters in the battle against ISIS in the city of Kobani. Members of Iraq's Kurdish Peshmerga have been travelling in convoys from Erbil in northern Iraq towards the Syrian city. The troops were welcomed by huge crowds as they made their way across Turkey. Earlier today, even more help arrived. Officials say some 200 Syrian rebels entered Kobani with mortars and heavy machine guns. Nick Paton-Walsh joins us now live from the Turkish town, which is about 15 kilometres north of Kobani. That's where crowds have been waiting for the Peshmerga forces to pass through. Nick, what's the feeling there?
Well, just behind me are where the Turkish police have their positions. They're comparatively relaxed, but have their gas masks at the ready. The crowd here has ebbed slightly. We just saw a Turkish police vehicle get booed as it drove through it. So decades-old animosity is still here, but the real expectation is quite, will these Iraqi Kurdish Peshmergas come through tonight? They could be as little as an hour, 2 hours away from here. Do they then stay here the night, regroup with those who have flown in separately to a nearby airport and then go in at dawn, or do they try and into Kobani? The Turkish military are in force now along that main access road down to the official crossing into Kobani from Turkey. So a lot of questions to be answered here. This day really began with a lot of surprise. Those inside Kobani who've been fighting for it for the past weeks had expected the Peshmerga to be the first to arrive. That's a convoy of well over 30 vehicles, heavy weaponry, armor, and also 150 plus fighters too. Instead, at about dawn this morning, they got anything by differing accounts between 50 to 200 Syrian rebel fighters. Now, this is really Turkey's idea, who suggested their president Erdogan that they could also go into Kobani from Turkey. They're led by a commander who, frankly, is a bit of an outsider, used to be a bigger player in the Syrian rebel movement, but is more on the outside now. He said he's got 200 men there, he could bring more. A lot of fighting happened after their arrival, and I do think many people here cheering the potential for the Peshmerga to go in, because that force and a town the size of Kobani, not that big, could potentially sway the balance inside, Lynda.
All right, Nick Paton-Walsh there. We'll speak to you very soon, I suspect, as soon as that convoy arrives in Kobani. Thank you very, very much. You're watching CNN Newscenter. Coming up next, the US now considers these Kurdish fighters its latest ally in the fight against ISIS. Find out where the group came from and why it is determined to defeat the militants.
Precision. Grace. Power. Every month, join us for a look at how things all around us move.
This month, improving speed and performance in transport.
0.3 seconds is the difference between coming out first and coming out fifth.
The Art of Movement, Thursday on CNN, in association with Amiga. life in the fast lane, in the car, and off the track. Stay ahead of the pack with The Circuit on CNN. Track the business behind the billions fueling the sport and keep up with Formula One. The drivers, the legends, and the technology that makes race day happen. Gear up for the US Grand Prix. Visit cnn.com/motorsport now in association with DHL.
Returning to one of our top stories now, Kurdish fighters have been holding off ISIS militants trying to take over the town of Kobani. Turkey says some of these fighters are linked to a Kurdish group it considers a terrorist organization. But the US considers the group its newest allies in the fight against ISIS. Ivan Watson has a closer look at the Kurdish militia that calls itself the YPG.
Don't be fooled by the pretty song. These women are part of a militia that is ISIS's most deadly enemy in Syria. Kurdish fighters from the People's Protection Unit, or YPG. They've fought ISIS on the ground in Syria for more than a year. Only recently, they started getting help from the U.S. in the form of airstrikes and weapons drops. A surprising turn of events for this secular, Marxist-rooted movement, which includes many fighters who have long battled America's NATO ally, Turkey.
An important part of this Kurdish movement's ideology is founded on gender equality. That means female fighters fight and bleed on the front lines. And that stands in sharp contrast to ISIS, which has been covering women up and hiding them from public life.
Addressing the crowd, a top Kurdish official who urges the fighters to protect their people from becoming slaves of ISIS. She is the co-president of one of three Kurdish statelets in northern Syria that have largely governed themselves for the last 3 years.
Our dream is to build a democratic society that includes Arabs, Christians, and Kurds living together in unity.
The Kurds call their region Rojava. Some of them clearly proud of their experiment in self-rule. Life in the town of Derik looks relatively peaceful and secular, unlike other parts of Syria taken over by Islamist militias. But the streets here feel empty. Many of the town's Christian residents have fled, and more keep leaving.
This is a sad day for your family. Why?
Yes, because they will go out from our country.
Peter Issa's tearful mother and sister wave goodbye from inside a 1954 DeSoto. Their final destination, Germany. The town's shrinking Christian flock can still walk peacefully through the streets to Sunday school, enjoying the protection of the Kurds. But the Kurds are paying dearly. At this memorial ceremony, mothers and wives of dead fighters. And this widow, she says ISIS killed her husband last year and mutilated his body. If I didn't have these children, I myself would go and fight, she swears. Her young son already wears the uniform of a future Kurdish fighter. Ivan Watson, CNN, Rojava in northern Syria.
U.S. President Barack Obama is meeting with health workers who are assisting in the fight against Ebola. Let's take a listen to his speech now.
To help save lives in Africa and here at home. As many of you know, I welcomed Kent and his wonderful wife, Amber, to the White House last month. And I was so moved by their deep faith, a faith that grounds their unwavering commitment to service, that I thought it'd be a good idea to have them back.